The more I try to do for that young lad, the worse I get off. All right. Good afternoon. Want to apologize about the late start. We had a few technical difficulties and some personnel difficulties. We're not going to mention no names, but we want to say welcome to the adult bootstrap class, and we're going to jump right into it. So if you would, let's open up our three pages. We're going to need a Google page today, and we're going to need a three schools page, and we're going to need a page. And what I'd like for you to be able to do, those of you who don't have it, I want you to open up one more page, and it is going to be my web page, which is www.nkcurlett.com. And we're going to look at some new items that I've placed on my page for the class to be able to access. And what I've done, I've done little modifications to my website, and we'll get to those in a few minutes. But in the meantime and in between time, let us go straight to our GitHub page. Tag, I did it again, people. I'm not clicking the tab. Opening new tab. That's what I'm not doing. I keep opening this. As far as how to enhance our cheesecake pages. But before we go there, I kind of want to give a shout out to our Saturday youth class. They were featured in the Blue 1647 Twitter feed on learning how to create a Jeopardy game of their favorite topic. And I got them, they're creating games from Dragon Ball Z to their favorite characters. Some of them are as diverse as doing some cultural type web pages based on the 90s. How they know about the 90s, I never know. I don't think something was born in the 90s. But they're doing I'm looking forward to seeing all the different websites that they're going to do and some of the challenging questions that they're going to bring up. It's based off of something that we've been doing. I showed them an example of us doing a page based off of those world famous super friends, and how they can literally take their web page and just enhance it to make the Jeopardy game really look like they really want to play it. So it's really, I'm going to apologize right now. The internet for me is running super slow. I mean, I think I walk faster than the internet is running today. And so, you know what? I'm just going to try to do what we need to do. So I'm just going to go back here to where I need to be, which is the W3 schools. And let's start with our first area. I'm going to, as always, I click the little house. The little house on the prairie here, and then I'm going to go to Twitter Bootstrap. So as soon as it comes up, again, I do apologize. We are moving everything is just really taking its time to come up. So here we go. It's trying to render. I wish I had a song to play or something like that, just so that we could get to it. We're going to go to Bootstrap, and we're going to open up our Bootstrap learning. That's Bootstrap in the tutorial. I'm not back up. Okay. Stream is trying to come back. The stream is back. So again, I hope Barbie stuck with us. She's following us at home. So it did just come back. So we're in the Bootstrap tutorial, and we're going to look at review some images. We're gonna we're going to look at some images. And the first thing that we talk about in our effort to create these wonderful web pages is we're going to go down the line, topography. And in topography, we know about the H1 through H6s, how we can use our headings and how they lay out. We know about the small tags, how in a heading we can create a secondary tag, next to the to our headings that makes it even smaller. So the next thing that we can look at is mark, where it can highlight. And the reason we're doing this review, because our next project, everything we've ever reviewed doing a web page, that's your next project. To take as many of the elements that we've done and create this awesome, fantastic website based on, guess what? Ta-ta-da-da, your own subject matter. So now I'm not going to tell you to do cheesecake. I'm not going to tell you to do anything of that nature. You're going to create the subject matter. I'm just going to tell you how many pages it's got to have and what it has to include as far as the elements. Okay? So here, we have abbreviations here, block quote, we reviewed, and a definition list. This was a big item that we use, especially when we actually start doing, when we wrote recipes for our cheesecake web page. Code, we didn't use code this time, but it's available. And then we did, Christian, help me out here, KBL, keyboard inputs, that's what it is. Keyboard inputs, we really, if you want to show how to use, if I want to tell you how to do a certain aspect, I could use what's known as a keyboard input, and it would show the keyboard input in this black button format to use Control P to say print. So we could do it that aspect. So I didn't use that. You got pre-text we didn't use, where once you use the pre-tags, it's almost like typing in Word. We didn't do many contextual backgrounds. We could have did fonts R. We could have did the actual lines itself. But again, here are the different contextual classes. Text capitalized indicates capitalized text. Initialism. So there are a lot of typology tags that we could have used. The text center, justified, no wrap. That means it will go on from now to eternity. And sometimes you don't want that. Tables we didn't really use, but when you're doing CSS, you can style a table. What we've been using, making tables without using the term table. So I really didn't get off into tables, but man, did we explore images. We explored images to the utmost. We looked at circle images, rounded images, image aspect ratio. I mean, we looked at how to format images using Paint. We looked at how to get images from Google. We've seen images in thumbnails. We've really seen just, wow, just images everywhere. We know that images done correctly can really lay out a website. That's one of the reasons why we did a cheesecake website, because I want you to see, right, and how just images of particular food types could make somebody hungry without really even typing content. So images are so important to a web page. Image rounded corners, image circle, image thumbnail. We talked about responsive images, how the images would go up and down and fit the particular web page. We talked about how to create an image gallery using the thumbnail, how we can have smaller images that would morph into the larger images to give us a better detail of the image. Great way to create a picture diary on your web page perfectly. And then it can also be in the video aspects of 4:3 and the 16:9, which is what most Haitian videos are, are what YouTube is morphing to now. So it gave us two classes to choose from. And then we had our world famous Jumbotron. Using Jumbotrons almost from the start. And a Jumbotron, we looked at how to create a Jumbotron. There were two types. First, we had the inside of the container Jumbotron, which gave us the rounded corner edges. Excuse me. Which was really awesome. We learned how to create that Jumbotron, how to lay it out at the top of the page, and how we could put it on other pages. So that was our first look at a Jumbotron. Then we had the outside container. The outside container didn't look as neat as the inside container, Jumbotron. So we kind of looked at that. So that was one way to look at it. And then we looked at the page headers that can go inside of a Jumbotron. And some people put a page header at the top of the page. Some people put it outside of the Jumbotron. So those are areas that we could look at. The next thing that we could look at were whales. You heard me talk about whales all the time. Whales, not whales. Whales are areas where you would see, these are my favorite thing in the whole wide world is how Bootstrap allows us to create buttons. Since we do not have any link to a page, we would put the pound sign in there because guess what? If you clicked on that link and had nowhere to go, we would get the infamous 404. And guess what? I didn't want a 404. I just wanted to show them how the button looked so it could, when it worked. So that's why we would do it. And then we had sizes for buttons. So they could be button large, medium, small, and extra small. And other thing, just to throw something at you, we found out what large, medium, small, and extra small meant when it came to columns. And that meant it pertained to, extra small pertained to cell phone, extra large was to all the way up to your large desktop screen. So we know how to use these buttons and where we would apply them. Then we had block level buttons. We saw this a lot when it came to using a page list, and we'll get to that a little later down the road. So here, the next thing we had that we used were called glyphicons. And glyphicons are, in fact, a type of icons that can go outside of text, inside a button, in a nav bar. They can go anywhere to help enhance what that button means. Excuse me. So here you see the envelope, which was normally would be used for email. You got print, which would be said to print. You got search, you got the download. And it says the glyphicon syntax is inserted with the following syntax. So you would have span class equals glyphicon indicating what we're talking about. And then the glyphicon name. So the type of glyphicon span. And then from there, so here's what we said it would look like. In fact, here's a link. You'll put your link there. Then you will put the type of glyphicon you're talking about, envelope, span, and close. So here's an idea. Search icon, span class, glyphicon. So if we looked at those items and went inside, looked at it, turn it this way, you can see what it looks like inside of a button, outside in a sentence if you'd been giving a descriptor. So this is what they would look like. So this is your glyphicon look. Especially buttons, you can also use it in your nav bar. Excuse me. The other, you can have badges and labels, your badges. Just to give you an idea, here you have comments here, so you can talk about how many different items are there. And the badges are just the different labels, and then you can, labels that are there. And here, you can have it primary seven. The following shows how to add badges to buttons. So if you wanted to say the order in which to push the buttons, you could have said that button one, button two, button three, or whatever it was associated. Primary one, primary two. So that could have been associated in the group. Say, for instance, you had football teams and you wanted them to know what's associated with which button is associated with each football team. You could say Steelers, one. You go Raiders, two. Okay, you could do it in that order. And so that can help with the simplicity of directing people how to utilize your website. So there are all kind of enhancements that could be used. We did talk about progress bars, but we did talk about pagination. And pagination is where we created some numbers, normally in the footer. They go to footer, and it actually shows the link to the actual page. So one could be associated with, you put your link number there. So this would go across. So here it's in the UL class called pagination, so it is a class, and it's set up where, in fact, link, the number expressed, close it, and that's how it goes here. It's shown in the active state. So it's just like we would do if it was a navbar or any other class, UL class, ordered list class, and we would give it the active tag. Okay? You can disable it. So if one is disabled, you automatically get the, as somebody said once, the Ghostbuster symbol. You can get the Ghostbuster symbol and show that it is disabled. Sizing, it can be large, it can be small. You can do pagination large, you can do pagination small. So those are the images. And then here are breadcrumbs. Another form of pagination is breadcrumbs. Breadcrumb class indicates the current page location within a navigational hierarchy. So here we have it. So here's the navigational class. If we were to look at it, here is how it would look. So right now it's saying we're in the vacation class. Look, there's no link to it. It disables it as far as movement, as far as a hovering ability, but that lets you know this is where I'm at. Here, look at the other underlines that you can get. So that's where that could get. So that's another way that we could use that particular item. List groups. Man, did we have a little fun with this one? We demonstrated how to take a basic list group, which says first, second, and third. Here it is combined with badges. So if I said, if I'm doing a recipe, I could say, use that number, that badge, 8 ounces or 12 ounces of, say, cream cheese. I could use it like that. Or here it is with linked items. If I wanted to link these to, say, one of my recipes, a full page recipe. Now here's the one with active state. So what we did was we took the active state and combined the active state with the basic list group, and that's how we created our recipe pages. So we didn't have the hover state, but we did have the first item active color state, and that allowed us to write some of our best recipes. We didn't use disabled item. See how it says disabled? We did with the first item, but we didn't use that one. And then we did use some contextual classes for the first one. So you could change it to any color you wanted. And that's basically what we did when the first line was what we used, except we didn't specify the first line. See how it says list group item, list item success? So that's a color. And then we could have just did list item, second item info. So that could have been just, instead of info, we could have just did as an item itself instead of giving it a color. So here, basically, is the layout, even though this hovers. We did the same thing with our recipes, except we took the hover out. That's the only difference. So we could have used that way. So far, so good. Another thing that we talked about was these wonderful panels. Now we looked at, now here's the heading of a panel, and here is the,
panel content.
Panel content. Now, does the panel have to be that wide? No. You could have put 3 on the page, 4 on the page. And I think we showed a web page where we actually use panel.
where it was three and describe the actual item it was a lead into. You could have put a video in there if you wanted to. You could get two panels on the page, put a video on one side, a picture on the other. However you wanted to do it. So that was just another way to use the panel example. And then you could have put the panel footer. So the whole item was, here's panel with contextual classes you could have did. Look at the different colors that you could have used. And all of these, the reason I'm not really harboring on these particular items is because we've done all of these. And this is our final week on our Cheesecake Project. So I really want to give those who have any questions or need an opportunity to finish up, because Thursday is our last day with the Cheesecake Project. And next week, we have a short week because of the Launch Code Gala. That's next Thursday. So we only have 3 days next week. Okay? Go ahead, sir.
We got to do this Thanksgiving. We'll open all the way up to Wednesday.
Yeah, Wednesday night. Thanksgiving, of course, they're closed. Probably that whole weekend, they're closed. And then back Monday, starting business. And I think our last day is December the
13th.
So it won't be long after Thanksgiving. We only have about 2 weeks left. Yeah, Molly's gonna bring us a sample cheesecake, so that we can taste some of her skills, and then Christian's gonna bring us some good beverages and everything. Cause on Saturday I get kind of spoiled on Saturdays.
Yeah,
y'all need to step up y'all game. Yeah, buddy. That's right, cream, rise to the top. I remember that. All right, so now drop downs. A drop down example can be in a button. Oh, it can be in a nav bar. But man, see, I didn't do this for you, and I can't show you everything. Some things I gotta let you do yourself.
I understand.
So here, you got a drop-down menu here that tells you example what's going on, and you could have clicked that, and then boom. So if we had this, north, south, east, and west maps. Let's look at that. You got me? It's just another way of cool coding. That's all. So you could have did that. You got the drop-down divider. So if we had the drop-down divider, so here we got the drop-down class is used to separate links inside a drop-down menu. What better way to do that? Wow, tutorial.
Now, if it was tight, though, you would actually click on the drop-down.
So this is up?
No, it adds HTML, then it took it somewhere else.
It's supposed to, but when you set it up, it will.
Oh, you got to set it up.
You have to put a link in there. Look, see, here's the code. They got a pound sign in there. But you would put a link in. Okay? That being said, here you got drop down header. Drop down header class is used to add headers inside a drop down menu. So here we got a drop down header. Here's the header for the drop down. And here's the header 2 for the drop down. Oh, yeah, so you can really lay it out. Let's say you're running the store. You got a store, it says drop down disabled example. So let's see. Oh, the CSS is disabled. So if that page is under construction or something like that, you can disable that particular page.
Drop down, we're going to be able to access it.
So you won't be able to access it. Okay? You got drop down position, the right aligned drop down. Let's see what it looks like. Look at that. So over to the right. Even though you click the button to the left. And then finally, the drop up. Which way is up? So you can go up, put a little razzmatazz snazz in what we're doing. Change it up. And then you can help improve accessibility for people with screen readers. You should include the following role and area attributes. Something we didn't talk about, but something needs to be talked about. Okay? So we go in here and look at it. So drop-down classes, you indicate a drop-down menu. Use the drop-down menu class to actually build the drop-down menu. So here we clicked it, role and area. So here, it's in this class. Excuse me. I don't know why every time we shut that door, I get congested. But here's the menu, drop-down defaults, toggle, span class is cat. So here, and LA role presentation, role equals menu item, tab index, minus one. So this is the setup. This is the one cool thing I really like about Bootstrap. Something that I don't have to do. Some items it thinks for me. Nothing wrong with knowing why it does it, but it's great to where you don't have to fight to actually create code. All it is, you have to know how to do it. It's like repairing a car. I don't have to know all the time about the combustion of a car, but as long as I know what needs to be there to make that combustion happen, and I put the right elements there, it will work. So that's a good thing. Because all of us are on rocket science. Now here's one of the trickiest things that I threw at you. I threw at you tabs. I threw tabs at you. And what tabs did was, it looked like this. And you could click each one and it gave you a different menu on the same page. And it looked like almost a notebook tab. This is some CSS three items. It says, see the last example, you want to find out how to make tabs and pills toggleable and dynamic. We always, right now, who wants a static web page? I don't. Even when we use GitHub, even though GitHub creates static web pages, there are some aspects of dynamic that they utilize. So here, we are creating, I'm going to say semi-dynamic. One of the things that we can't do in GitHub is the PHP function where it literally can house your PHP and you can link and do your email attributes and things of that nature. Now that won't allow it to do. But you can do some mock PHP, which I have been able to do. So that being said, the tab that we want to look at here is a tab with a drop-down menu. So you can still do this type of internal nav bar. This internal nav bar, as well as pills. Here are pills. Pills are buttons instead of tabs. But what we use here are vertical pills. They can go up and down. Here go pills in a row. Pills with a drop-down menu, center tabs and pills. So this is a combination of both. Toggleable dynamic tab. Now the toggleable dynamic tab, look, it closes. That's one of the things that we use for our recipes. We use the toggleable dynamic tab, and that allowed us to be able to go inside, and when we clicked the new menu item, it showed a completely new menu item under each one. So I had, on my website, I had a recipe under each one of the pills, under the tabs, and I had six going across. Could have did the same thing with pills.
It looked like a file.
This is a file.
I got
Right. So each one is separate. See, here was tab context. So we had the first one was active.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the next ones after that was menu one, menu two. It worked the same way as when we were doing carousel. There was always that first one that was active, right?
Mm-hmm.
You always got to have a starter, and then the rest of them follow behind. Always got to be a leader, so to speak. Always got to be a leader. Okay? So that was it. And the bootstrap nav bar. There are two types of bootstrap nav bars. What are they? Come on, somebody.
Logo nav.
Well, we knew that. Oh. But what makes them have what they have?
Reverse nav.
You got inverse nav, and what's the other one?
Oh, default.
Default, that's right. What did we do to inverse and default nav bars? We gave them what? Come on, Molly, help me out. What was the first one of the first questions you asked me ever about how you wanted your page to look? What did you ask me could we do?
Change the color.
Change the color. That was your first question to me. How do you change the colors? Yes, and we went in the what? Where did we go to change the color?
Style sheets,
the CSS. And we, thanks to Mr. Mohammed here, figured out as a class how to change the colors to our nav bar. It could even have to say logo nav as CSS. We could have made it just say CSS. It could have said McDaniel CSS. McDaniel.css. The objective was to be able to know how to manipulate the CSS itself. That was the objective. No matter what the name, the task is still the same. That's why you hear me a lot of times when we were actually in GitHub, I did not refer to line numbers. Because what I cared about the line number was nothing. What I wanted you to be able to recognize where the element was and the syntax characteristic. Because if you know how to find it, what good is it to me to know where somebody lives and then they tell me to go in the house and get my brush and I don't know where to look or what I'm looking for? What is a brush? You see what I'm saying? I got to know what a brush is first, right? Not only do I got to know where you live, I got to know what a brush is. Then I got to know where to find the brush. So that's the whole purpose. Our purpose with these different formats is to be able to recognize them visually without ever needing. Yes, it's great to have lines. It's great for them to highlight themselves in Sublime. But guess what? If we did it in WordPad, or it was in Notepad, I'm sorry, could you find that code? That's the key. You want to challenge yourself? Put your code in Notepad and see what you know. See what you know. That's a good way to test your skills. Put your code in Notepad. Come out of Sublime and just put it in Notepad and test yourself. It's a great way to test yourself. So that's what our nav bars look like. So here is the default. And it says all examples on this page will show a nav bar that takes up too much space on small screens. However, the nav bar will be on one single line on large screens because Bootstrap is what? Responsive. This problem with the small screens will be solved in the last example on this page.
The nav bar
will
go to the corner.
Oh! And what kind of nav bar is that, such that you're talking so well now?
Responsive.
It's responsive? Hey, I'm responsive to my wife, but she hollering at me. What does that mean? What do you mean? What are you talking about? So, what that means, here we got inverted, here we got default. But one thing, we had a fixed nav bar. What did the fixed nav bar do? It went where? It stayed where? Its navigation was fixed, will stay at the top of the page. Or the bottom. It could be top or bottom. Okay, that's one way. We use the fixed top class. The other thing we could have had a fixed bottom, of course. Nav bar with a drop down. We got a lot of people wanting to use their nav bar with a drop down.
Right.
Okay? But the other thing that we really, we got a right aligned nav bar. Look at that. Going to the right, going to the left. What went to the right? It wasn't my actual buttons, was it? It was the icon buttons, correct? So it's separated, almost like the Red Sea. One went on one side, the other went on the other side. It parted. But look at her. Look at that. Look at that. What did we do with this? What was this called? Man, we called that something. Website name, we changed it. I put a pretty little, I put a handsome picture of myself there in a circular form, and we called it a logo, but that was called a what? Nav what? That's the whole thing. What is that particular element? That was a brand. That's the brand. Like Brandon Cattle, that was my brand right there. That's how, hey, this is mine. I stamped it with some meat.
Right, oh.
Huh? I stamped it with some meat. This is mine. Okay? So that's what you do. When you creating your website and you putting that logo there for yourself, or you putting the logo there for whatever company or person you're designing for, you are stamping that with some you. That says website name. They don't say anybody name. So you are stamping that with some you or them, whoever you're designing for. That's what you're saying. Then we got our world famous buttons. Okay? And so here's what we was talking about, Mr. Anthony. The collapsing the navigation bar. And that's how we had that lovely little square in the corner with the three lines. You know what? I see it all the time. I see it on Google. I see it here on the W3 schools. I see it everywhere. So when I go in and look, I say Savoy Fire is everywhere. Look here. Here's our bar down here. We're in a vertical format, right? It goes all the way across the screen. But what happens? I'm sorry, the horizontal format. But what happens when I go vertical? Look at there. It transforms. And I get the three lines. The collapsible nav bar. In this example, the nav bar is hidden on small screens and replaced by a button in the top right corner. It says try to resize the window. So if I resize the window, oh, once I got to that size, that means my screen is larger, right? But man, when I'm looking at it here, on that little, some of y'all can look at iPhones, we gonna see there. See how it look? Mm-hmm. Here's, I'm gonna move to a, what's that, iPhone 6, 7. I moved up a little bit. Galaxy. Then we up to the 8-inch tablet. Now we up to the 10-inch tablet. Now I'm up to the full desktop. Is that responsive?
Yes.
All the way. What kind of web bar, nav bar we might want to use? That one. Because guess what? All of you have a style, whether you know it or not. Me, if you look at that bulletin board over there, help us all. That's my handwriting. And I was looking at that from a distance, and man, you'd have thought I was writing in some other language. Because it's kind of, you know, the more I do with a computer, the less I write. I used to have some great penmanship. Now, my teacher would have just put me in the corner somewhere because my handwriting is terrible. Some of you have great penmanship. But that's my style. Huh? The way I design web pages, that's my style. No matter what attributes, elements, syntax, or whatever you pull from using in Twitter Bootstrap, the web pages you do, that's your style. Some people design a more comical web page. Some people design a more serious web page. Some people can do either or. Some people can just fit in where they get in. But everybody has a style. Some people have dreads. Some people have low cut hair. Some people got long hair. Some people got beards. Some people don't. Some people got long beards. You understand what I'm saying? So everybody has a style. And that style is what you fit in. So when you write your web pages, your style, sometimes, a lot of times, people can look at you just like art and say, oh, Lisa wrote that. I can tell by this right here. Molly wrote that. I can look at all of you style use. All of you all style, and I can tell pretty much who did what. Chris, gotcha. I can pretty much tell you who did what. Just because I've been around you so much and looking at your different pages. That makes sense? Mm-hmm. Any questions so far? Mm-hmm. All right. So the other thing that we looked at too, we looked at media objects. Here is a great way to do block pages. I actually wrote some recipes. I made a combination of using the nav, the tabs, and the media object in a combination. See, classes can be combined. Because remember, we were looking at classes where we did double classes together. We even did the trifecta. But we had three classes under one class banner. Okay? Where I combined media objects and tabs together and laid it out where I could put in. I used glyphicons. And I was able to create a style to write a recipe that, guess what? Not only enhanced how the recipe looked, it was nice and neat. Let's say I used media ops, glyphicons. I used page lists too. So I combined all of them together with this. So that's actually four styles that I put together to make one page. And here, we look at media objects. They got it here where it's left justified. They got it, and then they got a nested media object. So if you were doing a family tree, you could say, this is my great grandma, so-and-so, so-and-so, and this is their first child, okay? And you could do it, and then right on this side could be where those are his children, boom, 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 boom. And then you come back over, here's my grandfather, and then here, and so on, so on, so on, so where he remarried or something. Or here's how the tree starts. So you could get really creative with this media object, not just for recipes. I just wanted to reiterate just how you can use these particular items to just make your web page really pop. And look at the spacing around that avatar. You could use your own image, because I actually use the same image sizes that I use for my logos on the branding part to display my cheesecakes. And I use the button class. So you could click on the button. Not only did I display the recipe, you could print out the recipe too. So you can, that's five class attributes that I put under one in one window. So you really could get down. And depending on how much you are willing to go in there and use that thing. I didn't say you couldn't twist it up. I gave you the basic requirements. If I was given a grade, I gave you what would get you a C. I hope I'm impressing that on you, that what I give you as far as the standard is what would get you a C as far as my eyes are concerned. Everything that you put on it, color combinations, instead of just using the basic color, learning how to put a gradient on a color, how to do multiple layers and throwing in multiple combinations. Because half the stuff that we reviewed and learned how to do as we were doing the web page, I did not put that in the instructions, did I? But I did not say you couldn't use it. One thing I hope I keep reiterating is, these are whose web pages?
Yours.
They're yours, that's right. I just told you what the minimum amount, what I expect you to have learned from it. Because every web page that we've done, we have grown in what the expectation is. The first web page, we did kind of basic HTML, right? The next web page, we did the side navigation, right? And we had a few attributes and elements. Well, we had three pages. and we got familiar with some of the icons, Font Awesome and things of that nature. But this next page, how many pages we had to do? Five? And we got really familiar with how to change color and use galleries. And there is nothing that you have learned that I didn't say you could go back and get and use. Never said you couldn't. Heck, if you had something that was really great on one of your first web pages and you wanted to duplicate it, I never said you couldn't do it. So I want to reiterate that. I've never said that you couldn't. In our next project that's coming up, I'm never going to tell you you can't take something you've already learned and make that part of your repertoire. That's the whole purpose of doing it. Getting your repertoire strong. Getting your consistency strong. Getting your knowledge base larger. I've been giving you resources. Every day I've come in and given you a new resource. Whether I hand it to you, whether I demonstrate it on the screen, and I said, I would bookmark this. Is that my phrase? I would bookmark this. But being adult, some things you got to do yourself. I ain't running around everybody computer saying, bookmark this, bookmark this. Number one, I ain't got that much energy. And then number two, that's childish. As an adult, we do adult things, right? All right. So, one of our favorite things that we really dug into, we've been doing this since we've been doing websites. How to create a carousel. Now that's something we've been practicing so long, I think that should be like, that's second nature pretty much now. Huh? Yeah. This should be second nature here, because carousel, that's one of the things, that and Jumbotron, we've been practicing that from day one. Now bar Jumbotron and carousel, we've done that every time except for our very first website, and that's when we just learned how to do a navigation board. But the carousel, and here, we do know that it's not supported in Internet Explorer 9, and because CSS3 transition and animations needed to achieve the slide effect are not there. But we went all the way down to the very bottom. It explains the carousel, and we use how to add captions. One of the things that I want you to know is we have learned, if nothing else, do you have to know all the code by heart in your brain? But what is the good thing to know? Your resource. Where you can go. Look, I know web developers that own corporations that write web pages. And man, they write some serious web pages. They know a lot of things off the top of their head. But guess what? They don't remember everything. The basic fundamentals, yeah. I showed you how to write a web page in Sublime. And how the first thing you have to do, the five attributes of a web page, you gotta have the document type, right? You gotta have the HTML. You gotta have a title. Then you gotta have what? The head, the body, the head, the body, and how to close those things, right? So you know you gotta have those. Even showed you a Sublime, how to hit a couple of buttons at the tab, and it automatically writes it for you. So there's no reason why. Sublime, you can even put support text in there if you want to. Not support text. The fake body text. I'm going to say that for lack of a better word. Degenerate out of my mind. There to hold space. Space text. That's what I want to say. Space text. It can do it. And you can go Sublime and get more. Just follow the instructions on how to put some more attributes there. So that's there. The other thing we looked at was the modal. We looked at the modal. And the modal was, you click this button, and I give you this. I give you this. I give you a little note. I'm giving you some instructions. You see it on my website, whether it be on our website where we get our class instructions, or even whether where we get on our web pages we've created. We've added the modal, some of you have, some of you haven't, but it's not like you haven't had the opportunity to see how it works and what you can do with it to enhance your web page. And then we looked at a scroll spy. I love this scroll spy. Now the scroll spy that we saw here we didn't use. You know why we didn't use it? Because if I go here inside this web page and how to create a scroll spot, and I go inside of here and look at it, here's the scroll spot. Now watch. See how it's changing color? See how fast that goes up? I didn't like that. Not one bit. Didn't like it. Never have liked it. And the only reason they use colors is just so you can see. And this is where you use an ID. An ID is the target. See where they have ID right here? ID that ball. This is a self-contained web page. And as you scroll down, and they're not showing it, but there will be JavaScript down at the bottom to show it going back. One of the things that we've done, thanks to Mr. Christian here, we actually learned how to take that JavaScript and create a file in our directory and have a link back to it so we don't have to have a ton of code going up and down. Why would we do that instead of having that ton of code all over the place? Why would you do that? I mean, the code is all right there and everything. Why would I create a link instead of all that code going down and put it in the file?
Keep on typing the code.
You don't want to keep typing the code. What opportunity is the greatest error? To type 40 lines of code or a couple lines of code? 40 lines of code, especially when they got a lot of squiggles and wiggles and dibbles. Right? So, but if I can put that code one time in a file and put it in a folder where CSS is located and call it JavaScript, call it Christian.js, and then have a link that says script.js, Christian.js, script, closing tag, which one is easier to do? Copy a Christian script. So that makes it a lot easier. And it simplifies life. Because guess what? When you're on the HTML page, where do you want to put your focus at? On the HTML. I don't want to weed through all that JavaScript. That's like going in my closet, as my wife said. That's a war zone. Okay? So that's what that is. So, questions?
I do have a question about blogging. So you said that we could do blogging using that one thing
that we have. The media object, you can set it up that way. Okay. Now blogging, there are some more elements to it. Okay. There are some PHP and stuff like that where people can actually write on your page. In today's world, you want to set up some security protocols that stop people from just robots and things from just writing random text. Like one time, I'll never forget, my first attempt at a blog. And it's the only time y'all gonna ever hear me mention this. Bay notified should mention it. I did a WordPress website. Man, that was a nightmare. Because I didn't have any security on it. And in my blog. And for every comment that I got from somebody that I wanted to hear from, there was this one robot that kept finding my website and trying to sell some football jerseys. And it would add all kind of code. Hi, this is Rebecca, and I blah, 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 blah. And Rebecca would take up seemed like 40 pages of my blog. And I would have to go through there every week and delete that stuff. And so I just canceled the page because my security that I had was antiquated because I was only using JavaScript at the time and I wasn't versed enough to get the capture and all this other stuff. So I just said, you know what, I'm done with this.
I need $1,000 a week just for looking for an appointment.
Yeah.
And you can too by clicking this
link. You can too by clicking this link.
I thought you were going to say how you do it.
No, that's a very common spam.
That's a common spam.
Type up our reservation letter.
You might get it again.
Yeah. So the other thing, so we did the scroll spot. I did it simple. We went to a place called Bad Company. I always say that. It's called Company, the company thing. And we actually went and looked at the actual code for the scroll spot that they used on this page. And I've always thought this scroll spot was just so good. And so what it did was, number one, what it did first, what it allowed us to do, we took the body tag, the body ID, and we put it so the target was our navbar. We replaced the body tag on our web page, that any page that it had, and I told you my golden rule, if you had to move the wheel more than twice, you need a scroll spot. So we took the body ID and we copied it and put it on our page everywhere we wanted the scroll spot. That was the first thing we did. The second thing that we did was we went down low and we copied, to start off, the footer. We copied the footer class from footer all the way down to the end of the HTML, and we pasted it on our first page, the index page. After that, as we matured, we actually took the script tag where we had this, and we created on our website, we actually took this script right here and cut it out of our web page and pasted it in a file and created a JavaScript file. And when we create our JavaScript file, then we came back and we created a JavaScript link. So now all we needed to do was add the link instead of the script tags. So that's what we did. But this particular code, man, this is some well-written code, and this is something I probably will always keep in my arsenal because I just love the way that scroll spot looks. And here's the kicker. It has the glyphicon. It put the glyphicon chevron up. But you could have put anything there. You could have changed it to up button or anything you wanted, the up arrow, whatever you wanted to do. There's nothing to say that it had to be the chevron up. You can change it to whatever you wanted it to be. Could have been a picture of you, could have been some balloons. Anything, you could have got creative. Could have been a piece of cheesecake. You know, I did, see? So it's something that you could use on that particular item. So that's what we did. And last but not least, we looked at the grid system itself. Here's one of our first by the way, color picker. We learned about color and CSS. Since we're here, I'll do that first. We learned about color and how we can select colors that are relevant and how to write the hexadecimal or how to write the RGB colors for these. So here are the RGB colors that you could have used. So those are, and here for some deeper reading, Crayola colors. Those of you who want to use Crayola colors by the color names, look at that. When we look at Muhammad, looked up and saw all them reds up there, and his eyes kind of lit up there. So we could actually use Crayola colors. So here are the Crayola color names. Look at that. So that box of 64 that you used color with, everybody remember that box of 64 or that 128? You know, in grade school, you had the 8 and you had the 16 and the 32s. See, I still remember them names. See? But here, tart orange, orange soda, bright yellow. And yes, your graphics card will display them as different colors. But you know what looks good to you. You know what looks good to you. That's black all day. I think we actually use this color, 1B, 1B, 1B. So here go your metallic looking colors. Look at here, orange alloy. Last time I saw orange alloy, you know what that was called? Rust. That was called rust. So you got Crayola color, color brands. How about that? That's something, look at, what is these? Oh, look at the Twitter. So
Here's Google colors, Twitter colors, Facebook colors, Microsoft colors, Yahoo, Intel, Instagram, IBM, Amazon, Netflix, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, IKEA, Android. So wow, look at all those colors, color brands. The hottest spring colors for 2017, Niagara, Primrose Yellow, Lapis Blue, Flame, Island Paradise, Pale Dogwood, Greenery, Pink Arrow, Kale, Hazelnut, and for last year, or this year, the coolest, look at that shark skin. Look at all these different colors for fall. Ain't that something? Man, so that's something that you can look at, the different colors. You got RGB, hexadecimal, HSL, HWB, a CMYK, that's a cyan, magenta, yellow, and let's just go there and look. And this is the standard for CSS4. So look at her, it's the blackest look I thought it was. Black. So okay, the color is black. So here's support. It is not supported, listen. That's why we didn't go over it. Not supported by HTML. But guess what? All your printers use it. And this may be the new standard for CSS4. Huh? So that is something. You got a color converter, which what we look at. So here's the color, RGB. Here's the typewritten name, RGB, the hexadecimal color, the HSL color, the HWB color, the CMYK color, the NCOL. You notice these last ones? You don't see them used too much. Some of them are super duper new. Can you see? So some of those are super duper new. So I wouldn't worry about those. But this is the color converter. And all this you can find at the W3 schools. That's why I say know your resources, what you can use. Okay? So that being said, where was I trying to go to that you threw me out, Alicia? I was looking at you thinking about all them chocolates. So that's something. You got all different aspects. I mean, look at the multiple chocolates or multiple reds that you actually can use. I mean, so when it comes to color, so here where we are. Again, we're talking about the bootstrap grid. Here's the span class, 12 across, span in fours, span 8 to 4, span 6 to 6, span 12. So you can go 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1. So it doesn't matter. The grid classes, we're talking about extra small, small, medium, and large. The system rules. Rolls must be placed within a container. Fixed width or container fluid. Full width for proper alignment and padding. Use rolls to create horizontal groups of columns. Horizontal groups of columns. You can have 12 columns, but you got to have a row to put them in so they line up right. Content should be placed within columns, and only columns may be immediate children of rows. Hello. So you got to have a row, and the columns go inside the row, not outside the row. So you don't put the, unless it's nested. Predefined classes like row and say column span 4, column small 4, are available for quickly making grid layouts. Don't reinvent the wheel, it's already there. All you gotta know is the what? You gotta know the multipliers of 12. Okay? Columns create gutters, gaps between column content via padding that is offset in rows for the first and last column by negative margin on rows. So in other words, there is some padding going around it. Okay? There is some padding going around it. And then, last but not least, grid columns are created by specifying the number of 12 available columns
you wish to span. For example, three equal columns would use three column small fours. And small fours mean the smallest it can get to is what? Cell phone. Okay? So that being said, it is almost, last thing, then we're going to break. Here, this tells you how the devices, how it falls out for devices. Especially when you see the term media, especially in your CSS, this is how it knows. Extra small devices and phone, you notice the arrow is going to the left, that's going to the west. That means the grid behavior container, the prefix class, that lets you know how to set it up. Are they all nestable? Yes. Do they have offsets? Yes. Do they have column ordering? Yes. So all these here, you can see how to set it up for a tablet, how to set it up for a cell phone, how to set it up for a desktop. So these are all your resources. So that being said, we're going to go on break, and when we come back, we're going to look at, I told you I would have the handouts today, which I do, so we're going to do a read through or look at what it consists of and how it's going to apply to us. Okay? So let's take a break. All right?
Welcome back. We're here. We're back from break, and I am helping one of the students. She was having an opportunity with getting her gallery together, her non-gallery that acts like a gallery. So here, I actually here created a class called Gallery, and then I floated it left. I gave it a margin of 10 pixels, padding of 5, width is 305, and the height was 250. And I gave it a border color, 2 pixels, solid, and I gave it a color that matches my website. The other opportunity that I jumped on was I created a gallery H4 class, which where the background is the same color as my border, and my font color was white, and I wanted it bolder, so I created the font weight bolder, font family. You always need 3. You need a serif, sans serif, which is this one, serif, and a monospace. You need the 3 categories. And then I did a text align center. So those are the 2 areas here that I created to add where I could put that cell pattern. You got it? Where I could do that cell pattern on my a column pattern on my index page, and it not be a thumbnail gallery. Because I didn't want the images linkable. I just wanted to show the different varieties that I was featuring on my webpage. Okay? So that's what I did there. Okay? You're welcome. Okay. All right. So the other thing that I've done, we are preparing, first of all, those of you who are not here, I just want to give you a reminder that next Thursday there will be no class, but as a class, we are invited to a gala for the celebration of LaunchCode and its 3rd anniversary here at this location. There's going to be a 30 minutes of class demonstrations where the students from the different participatory endeavors will be featuring their products, and our class is going to have some of the students demonstrate their with their projects that they have been working on. So we're looking forward to a fun-filled night. It's going to be a very festive night. So I'm just going to say, dress appropriately because there will be corporate sponsors here, so you'll get to mingle with some of LaunchCode's corporate sponsors as well as some of the graduates, and you don't know who you may create a relationship with. So if you do have any business card, I have them on hand, and just hope for the best. Okay? The other thing is next Thursday being actually an off day for us, our project is probably needs to be due next Tuesday. It can be due next Wednesday, but we'll look at it. We're going to be looking at project next Tuesday. As you know, I'm not here on Wednesday, so if you had anything you wanted to tighten up with it for the gala, you can use that Wednesday to tighten up projects and assist one another. So that's what we're going to, we'll use that. But next Tuesday, I'm looking forward to this because most of you are done anyway. So we're moving forward. The other thing that we're doing, I kept my promise, and I did bring the handouts that I said I was going to bring. Man, it took me a minute because I got 2 printers, and I had both of them working. One of them can do front and back. The other one, I manually got to do it. So there was some mistakes done on some paper here. But, and you also can go, can I leave this? Okay. So we can go to my website, and that website is, we're going to go to my website, which is nickcurlett.org, and we're going to actually look at, I have a new note here. First and foremost, there's a lesson update. It says the class message. The final class project is located
in the drop-down menu along with the new Get Bash instructions. So those of you who don't know, you do now. I've already uploaded the new instructions for us. So in downloads, if you go to Get Bash, I have revised these. You just click revise if that comes up in color. And these are the new Get Bash local repository instructions. And here I have all the Git commands. I tell you exactly what a lot of the terminology means at the very beginning of the page. The Git major commands with examples. You're going to see Git config, Git initiate, Git clone, Git add. You're going to see a lot of these, Git commit, Git status. We're going to use all those commands. So we're going to use those commands, and so we're not going to use all of them. We're going to do a push. We're going to do a remote. We're going to do Git log. So here are a lot of Git commands that we actually do use. There's some diagrams, not necessarily really necessary, that we use. And then we have the actual code that we're going to use to actually create our repositories to upload to our Git repository using Git Bash. So these are the instructions, and we're going to actually take it all the way and create an actual CNAME domain. So that means we're not going to be, it may be in Git, but guess what? It's going to say, when I do this web page, it's going to say nicholascurlett.com. It's not going to say getnkcurlett.git.io/blah blah 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 blah. This is going to actually be a website that is going to be housed on, I'm going to have given an actual domain name. So if you want to do this, one of the things that I did was I went out and I went to Abasco, used to be Yahoo, and I went and bought a domain name. So whatever the domain name is you want to use, I purchased a domain name for this particular assignment. The domain name that I purchased was $9.95 for a year. Okay? Then you have to register with Who's It, the whole nine yards. And that's all I did was purchase it. I did not, it says that it's waiting to be, it's under construction. If somebody get it, you would get it under construction. One of the reasons I haven't done anything with it, because I'm saving it for this assignment. Because I'm going to take our next project that we create in Git Bash, and I'm going to attach that project to that name. And so that's going to teach you how to attach a CNAME project to your actual project that we create. Now, I just happen to have the instructions with me. So, I know that there are some people in our class who can read the little books. It's convenient for them to put them together. So you want a big book or paper. Okay, so whoever left gonna get one of the little books. Okay, so here is the local repository Git Bash. There are two of them. Here you go. Which one you want? Little book or big book?
I don't care.
You don't care? Good. Which one you want?
Paper.
Paper? Which one you want? Which one you want? Oh, okay. Okay, so here you get that one. Here, get her one. Which one you want?
I'm like,
okay. Pass one for Anthony. You doing the book? Okay. So here's the book. Okay. So all of you now, this is the Git Bash local repository. This is what we're going to be using as far as the program is concerned on how to do it, with some commands and shortcuts. What I realized was when it came to a Mac, since we're using Linux, they all the same, pretty much. So you have it there.
So I have a question about you guys. What's the
It is a type of, yes. It is a method of FTP, but this is coding. This is actual coding. We will be creating the website in straight code. And so we will be using, like you had DOS, or you have PowerShell, or that. We're going to be creating the website in straight code to create it. I didn't say finish. And we could do a number of projects, a number of entries, the whole nine yards in it. But my objective here is to get you familiar with GitBash. Because some of you, especially when we go to this gala next Thursday, you're going to see what the other class does. And you're going to actually see how they do their work. And they're going to be writing in a terminal format. This is excellent, a practice opportunity for you to get you familiar, because some of you won't even start getting some of these IT jobs and things of this nature. A lot of companies actually do writing GitBash. Okay? So this is just exposure. How do you know what you want to do if you've never been exposed to it? So that's why I'm taking this opportunity to expose you to every possible thing that I can expose you to before you go to the next level. Is that fair enough? And I think we've covered quite a bit when it comes to exposure, when it comes to utilizing today's technology and what's available for you to do some great work. So where you go from here, is it dependent on me after this class? No. It's dependent on you. It is dependent on you. Okay? So I just want to walk through this, since I have it on the screen. I just want to walk through this. So I told you about the terms and what they meant. But what I really want to look at are the commands. And as we go through them. Right now, we're just going to walk through them, and I may do a brief demonstration on how it works. First and foremost, here's your repository commands. It says git config double dash username GitHub username. So I don't expect you to type anything right now. I just want you to see. As a matter of fact, I'm going to do something else here too. I am going to go to this and open this, and I am going to open this just so you can see what I'm talking about. So I am going to open it so you can see what I'm talking about. Let's see if we can do a little bit at a time as we see what's going on. See if we can do both. All right, so it says the git config user global username. So here it says, this is your GitHub username. You will be using these two quotation marks on both ends, but here where it says this, I would click here, and my global username that I have exposed is NKCURLETT. So I would go here. I did it all back. That would have been my first error. One thing I should explain before we get started, if you didn't get a chance to read it. This is the name of my computer, Student67-PC. That's the name of my computer. And it's at the very beginning of your book on the very first page. It tells you exactly what these terms mean. Ming W64 with the squiggly line here. This Ming W64, this is telling you that I have a what? 64-bit computer. I have a Windows 64-bit computer that I am using. That's what that means. Now, every command, I'm not going to say every because there are some commands that do not start with get. But 99% of the commands you use in Git Bash start with the term G-I-T. Okay? And unless indicated, there is a space between everything you type. Did you hear what I said? Unless indicated, there is a space between everything you type. So when you see that says git config, what I am doing now, I am configuring my computer to match my repository user. I have three repositories under three different names. So if you are, if you're not on your repository right now, where it's not set up to be the current repository you're going to do here, you're going to go so far in the process and it's going to give you an epic fail. Two things that I found out the hard way. I use what's known as an SSH security key on one of my repositories. Because I did it in Git Bash and set it up in Git Bash, I cannot use my desktop computer to do this assignment unless I use that particular repository. So if you use SSH key generator, keep that in mind. And they are very, very difficult to remove. Very difficult to remove. I can remove it from the repository, but I cannot remove it from my Git Bash on my desktop. So that is my new work in progress. I'm halfway there. Okay? So I typed in git config, and I am a horrible, horrible typist. But one thing that I have learned, every time I type something, I better look up and see what I typed. So far, gitconfig.global.user.name/. Now, make sure you get those double quotation marks, because I made a mistake of having a single and then typed everything in a double, and I put my computer in a loop. And I had to exit out and start over again. Even when I typed clear, it didn't work. Clear just coming up with a triangle next to it. So I had to exit out and get out. So make sure you do it. So I typed my username. Being neat, following what it says, and just hit enter, and I get to move to the same thing. Here is the area that's very important, especially if you are doing this with multiple emails. The thing that I've learned, when I change emails, I need to change this. User email, you need to know your email. If you don't know your email, I suggest you know, find out what it is. And no, it's not giving out your password. It's no more than I would give out if I was giving out my email to one of you. So here is user email@gmail.com. And so, no error so far. Now, here is telling me create a new repository in GitHub. So I need to go now to GitHub and create a new repository. Guess what I've already done? Let's see. I'm going to be in GitHub and I'm going to go back to GitHub and I'm going to go to my GitHub and I'm going to go to one that I have already created, and the name of that repository is going to be, I'm going to open up what's known as Nick's Barbecue, Nick's BBQ. You see, it's award-winning, my virtual barbecue restaurant. Now, the next thing you do once you create the repository, since all of us have GitHub accounts already, all of us have GitHub accounts, I want to go here and see this green bar where it says clone or download. The next step is to hit that drop-down menu. And you're going to see this code, that's opening desktop, download zip, and a little clipboard. Click the little clipboard. Do not click opening desktop. Do not download zip. Yes, we have opened in the desktop before using the desktop application, but this time we're opening this in the Git Bash. So we're doing another procedure. So once I do that, I am going to go back to my Bash and go back here. See, I can just open it here and see what's flashing right there. So now, the next step, since I want to see, come here. I want to see my layout. Come here, Bashy. So here I am in Bash. I'm scrolling down. So here it says, let's make sure we created the repository. We did the drop down. Everything I just demonstrated to you, those instructions are right there. So if you get home and want to practice yourself, those instructions are right there. Okay? So the next thing that's coming up is we're going to type in user CD desktop. This is what I realized that I needed to do a little differently. I had to restructure this. If you looked at some of my old work, I had it a little backwards. So here I'm going to type in CD, type in desktop. So I type in desktop and I'm going to hit enter. Guess what? So it hasn't done anything, but it's telling me now where you see Ming 64 dash, it says now the level that I'm at is the desktop. So now what I want to look at is I want to look at the level. So now look, it says what's on my computer. It says QuickBooks Premier Account Edition. Start Bootstrap, simple sidebar GitHub pages, what's down, Windows 7, 64-bit net install. So it's showing me what it sees on my desktop. What else does it see? If I scroll back up, it says Dell Downloads, GitHub Shell. It says Burgers. So this is what it sees on my desktop. And the only reason it's so small is because, in fact, that's what's there. So the next thing that I'm going to do, I'm going to type in the word clear. Type in the word clear. That's one of the few terms that you'll see that does not need the word get. Okay? So I enter, and so I have a desktop. Yes, it's clear. It just gives me a clean slate. Is everything gone? Christian, is everything gone? No. It just means it's out of the way so I can write. You can scroll up to see what everything that was there. So here, now I want to type in git, G-I-T, clone. I typed in git clone, space, and remember when I went up and I copied that clipboard? So now here's where clipboard comes into play. I'm going to paste it. And guess what? Look what it did. What did I do wrong? I just got git clone.
You must specify repository to clone.
Yes, sir. So I just got git clone. But look what it gave me. It gave me all this different code. All this different code pertaining to it. When I typed in git clone, it gave me everything that I could use. But here's the problem. When I typed in git clone, when I, Nick Curlett, typed in git clone, once you copy it, you need to use it. So here, I need to first and foremost, I am going back here, guess where I'm going? To my GitHub. I'm going to copy it to the clipboard. I am going back here, and I can go down here. I want to be on my instructions. Definitely want to be on my instructions. Here, there we go. And for those of you who follow me, I'm using like two screens. So git, clone, I am pasting. You see how it came up? See where it says GitHub now, nickcolette.nicksbarbecue.git. So I'm at the end and I hit enter. It is cloning that repository. So it's cloning the repository from up. So it unpacked all the object, it downloaded. It said total of 30. 30. So I really got a full web page up there for real. 30. Unpacked objects, 30 of 30, done. So I am done with that. So now, here, I can get clone. You see where it says CD, what's up, /? Now, what's up is what you guys got, what's down, right? What's up was another one I made. So what's up is just, is an example repository name. What you're going to use is your repository name. So make sure you know that. So I'm going to type in CD, and I'm going to do space, and what's the name of my repository? That's a good question, huh? Is it Nicks-Barbecue? How do I know? Well, I could do this. I could paste it and it says Nicks-Barbecue. I could do that. So I can go, I can backspace that. And guess what? You can't backspace like you would with your mouse where you're highlighting backspace. It won't do that. So here, I'm just going to backspace it back. But I got the right name, don't I? Nicks-Barbecue. And you got to use your forward, backwards, up and down keys to move around and get bash. You can't just take the mouse and jump. You understand? Y'all with me?
Yes.
Okay, and I did write that note on your document. And finally, you have to have a /. See how I have /? And then I go enter. So I have enter. So it says Nicks-Barbecue. So now look, we're on the desktop. We're on Nicks-Barbecue. Uh-huh. It's in master. What is master to us in GitHub?
It's the trunk of the tree.
Right. It is master. When we do master on our web page of GitHub, what are we in? What are we in when we do master in our repository?
We're
in the repository, and that's the master. And where do we always end up being?
In GH pages.
But for right now, we are writing the master pages. That's one of the reasons it's saying master. That's the part of GitHub we're in right now. And once we get back to GitHub, I'll show you how to get everything moved, pushed to the GH pages. Okay? You don't have nothing to move. Y'all, only thing y'all had was a README. Right. I did this. I'm just showing you how it works right now. Okay. I'm not expecting you to do anything right now. I want you to take notes on the papers I gave you. So if you have any questions, we walk you through this slowly so you can see what it looks like. And so we can walk through this slowly and eliminate as much confusion as possible. I should have said that. Follow me. Follow me and take notes. Okay? So, once I've done that CD, what's up? Let me move this up so the people at home can see. Once we get that CD, what's up, we're going to go to a LS, and we're going to go to the next level, and it's going to tell us, come here, you. Sometimes my mouse gets a little stuck there. We're going to go to a LS. And that LS tells us where we're going to go. That's the level underneath the what's up. That's the level underneath the what's up. So once we're in that level, so we're here in that level underneath the what's up. So I'm going into the barbecue. So I'm going to go LS and hit enter. And so now the first thing that hit me was with the README in the barbecue, right? Because that's the only thing on the master, right? That's the only thing on the master. So we're there with the LS on the readme. So now I'm going to do what's known as a Vim. A Vim is a text editor in GitBash. And it comes with GitBash. So I'm going to go Vim, space, and readme is all capitalized. So I have to do it all capitalized. Readme MD, and I'm going to hit enter. So now I'm going to open this up a little bit because this is something that we need to kind of look at. This is the tricky part. In order to write in here, you can't just start writing. On your laptop, some of you have INS on your laptop. I don't know if some of you do, some of you don't. You have a button called insert. You look, hold down the shift, you can get the insert. On Dell's, it's in the upper right-hand corner. Or you can tap the I button. So I'm going to tap the I button just to be consistent. And it gives me the term insert. So now I can type in this Vim. And that allows me to write a sentence in Vim. So if I want, it says my virtual restaurant. So here, I'm in it, I'm here, I'm in my Vim. So here, you see my cursor? You see it? I think I blew it. So here we go. I need to move my cursor all the way down to get to the end of the sentence. My virtual barbecue restaurant, I'm going to go featuring, I said succulent. S-U-S-L-C-C-E-U?
E-L-S-U-C-C-U-L-E-N-T.
Succulent.
Yeah, it's spoken.
Succulent. Tender. Mouth-watering. Smoked. Ooh. Apple. Ooh, I spelled apple wrong. Too much on my mind. You ain't lying. Apple. Apple. Wood. Ooh, help me. Smoked.
Brisket.
Ooh, okay. Brisket.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Brisket. Okay. You see how? Okay. So we got a beef brisket. My virtual barbecue restaurant featuring succulent, tender, mouth-watering, smoked applewood, smoked brisket. Yeah. I should just say smoked. I should say applewood. Applewood smoked brisket, but I like smoke so much. Let's keep smoking. Okay, so we got that written, right? Now, just to show you what else I can do, here is something that most people don't know. I can go and open up on my desktop computer Sublime. I can open up Sublime. Let's see. Let's go back. That's not how I want that. As much, you want to say changes? No. Okay. I'm going to do this new. I want to go to my desktop. So here, I'm going to go to my desktop. And in my desktop, I can now see it won't do it, but Nick's Barbecue is on my desktop. So I can literally go in Nick's Barbecue. There it is. And you see where it says readme? I can open this readme. I can open this with, share with, or open with. Let's see. Open. I don't want Windows to open it. I should be getting, here it is.
share with? I need to open with. Let's see if I do it here. I'm not getting open with. That's amazing. Send to, that's documents, compress zip mail. Huh? Huh. I'm not impressed. My MD file, open with. No. No. This is not a shortcut. Anyway, I'm in the Vim. I'll come back to it. So I've edited my bash here, right? I'm done editing. You have to push the escape button. You have to come out of insert. And then you're going to do colon. And if you do colon Q, it's in your instructions. Colon Q, that will quick close the document and get you out of it. I want to save this. So I'm going to do X. And then I'm going to hit enter. So now I've done Vim readme, I've done the Vim, I've done the whole nine yards. And so I've come out, I've done the Vim readme. So your next step, let's see where we're at with all this. I'm going to do git status. So, oops, statue. Remember I told you I type first and then go look? Because guess what? I do not want to make a mistake and have to do this all over again. So patience is the virtue. I'm going to hit enter. And so it's telling me on the git status on the branch master, my branch is up to date with the origin. Branch changes not state for commit. It says I modified the README. It says no changes into the commit. So now it says git add or git commit dash A. So the next thing that I want to do, since I did, I want to do git add the README. Okay? So just like it's telling me to do, git add, do the space, and then the README as it is written, README. .md. Once I do that, I am flashing. I move forward. And so I have did the git add README. So I've done that. So now I need to make a comment. I need to make a comment to GitHub, the repository, let them know, hey, I'm coming. Okay? So the next thing that I want to do is I'm going to do git and I'm going to do the commit. I'm making a commitment to it, dash M, okay, space, quotation mark. Remember, in this quotation mark, who am I making this, I'm making a message now, and I'm going to say, updated the README. Now here, I don't have to worry about it being capitalized. Because all I'm doing is telling you what I tell, saying what I did. Okay? So here, I got everything the way it's supposed to be. Enter. So it's saying, commit M, updated the README. That's my message. And it's giving me the master, updated the README, one file change, one insertion, one deletion. So it's telling me what I've done. So now I can go get log. So I go to git log just to track my contributions. Here are my contributions that have been made so far. So, and the most recent contributions at the top. So every time you've done here to see every step along the way. So the most latest contribution today, Monday, November 7th at 8:25. Yeah, it's that late. It said that I have, in fact, and then on October 31st, I did one. So I've done that. So now,
My next step is to, in fact, I don't need to do the status all over again. I could, but I don't have to. So now I want to go to here, and I want to go to get, R-E-M-O-T-E, remote, and origin. Now here is where I have been messing up for a long time. I was misspelling origin every time. I was leaving out an I. So let's see if I still got my copy and paste here. I do. So I still have my copy and paste there. And once I do that, I am going to hit enter. So it says fatal. Remote origin already exists. Am I in trouble? Not yet. So now I am going to go to just go ahead and push it up. So it's established. So it's telling me, you just go ahead and send the thing on up. It's already established. You don't have to keep redoing this. So now I am going to go to get push. I'm going to push dash U, okay? And I'm going to go O-R-I-G-I-N. Excuse me for so being so juvenile, but I know me. Okay? And I'm going to go master. Origin master. So I say push origin master. And so this is what's going to be sent up. And I'm going to hit enter. Okay? So I've hit enter. It's thinking. Let's see what he do. And it is saying that get push you origin. Counted objects, 3 done. Delta compression using up to 4 threads. Compression. So, that's what that's saying. How do I know? I'm going to go back here to this. Now, we have GitHub, and we have the GitHub README, right? So, we're here, it says virtual barbecue restaurant. So, here, I should be able to refresh this page. And it says, my virtual restaurant featuring succulent, tender, smooth, mouth-watering, apple-smoked, wood-smoked brisket. So all that code I wrote in Git Bash is now uploaded. I could have put files in there. I could have put index file in there and created that. I could have actually went to my text editor, my Sublime text editor, and in fact put a whole process in there that we've been doing and made it work. But just to show you where we're at, here I have branches and it has some GH pages. So I've done GH pages branches here before already. So when I go back here and I ask, I'm in the master, I go back to GH pages, I already had created a whole website. But when we do what's up, I'm going to show you how to turn basic index into the master page, how to turn that into get the help page. Yes, sir.
I'm sorry.
Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Okay, so that's how I was able to use GitBash to push to the web. When you are starting to get more and more into your coding with Hello World and different things like that, you're going to be using the underbelly coding to actually create web pages. You can see I actually could update and upload and do a web page, bring it from the desktop from the repository to my desktop and backup. We've used applications, desktop applications. We've done it created a simple web page, but this is probably the most coding that we've actually done on a computer. So what's going to happen is tomorrow we're going to actually practice this. And then we're going to practice Thursday how to create a file and send it up. I want you to get a little familiar with how to create files in Git Bash so that you understand the coding that's involved to create a file. And that way, whether you create web pages or you start getting into JavaScript, Linux, or whatever you want to do, you have a, you're starting to get familiar with the language. Okay? So that's what I wanted to do, and I wanted to review this today first to show you where our next steps are going. I want to just slam everybody with, oh, by the way, we're finna do this now. I want to give you piece by piece. So we got the appetizer now, baby. Huh? We ain't got the full meal yet, but we ain't got the appetizer. Is that all right, Mom? Huh? So we're doing a little learning. So the other thing, too, that we have, is that okay with you, Mr. Christian?
Yeah. Yeah? But you can't figure out what's the advantage of doing it this way.
Because if you ever go into coding and you get further along in coding, you get to working with JavaScript and Python, this is where you work. You work here. You don't work. You don't work in them. Them.
You don't work in
you. That's a GUI. Yeah, it's GUI. This is what them scientists out there be using. You want to get where they at? I'm taking you where they dwell. You where they dwell now. This is how they do their work out there, and their homework and everything. They dwell in this land. Yeah, you see no more pretty colors and all that other stuff.
I'm trying to adjust.
Uh-huh, that's okay. That's why we're getting a little bit at a time. So also, for those of you who have not figured it out yet, your next lesson, that says lesson 4, just so you know, the next project is already posted. That's right. So you can start working on it now if you're already done with it. One of the things that you can start doing that it says this project will consist of a top navigation with a minimum of 6 pages and a minimum of 4 active social media icons. The navigation bar will feature either your logo or your choice of rounded edges or circle image of you with a drop-down menu. The page must meet the following criteria. All CSS is external. Minimum of 3 Google Font APIs. A Google Map API. All pages that require scrolling include a scroll spot. All navigation bars must be of color, not black or default. All navigation bars must indicate if they are active and possess the hover feature. All buttons must include a glyph icon, or there should be R font, awesome icon. All sites must start in the Git Bash terminal. That's why we're doing it. So the site you create will start in the Git Bash terminal. All sites must be interactive, accessible, internet accessible, with outside of GitHub. In other words, that if I wanted to go to your website, I need to see, you need to give me a link so I can look at it from my cell phone. Other than just saying, it can say Christian@github.io, but I need to know that link. So then there must be internet accessible. Where was I at? All sites, okay, here we go. All pages are titled with a title that reflects its content. Example, Nick Curlett homepage. I don't want to see where it would say, find awesome Joe Weber's website or something like that, or what you used to do. I need to see what you got right there. You need to the home page needs to have a jumbotron and carousel with a maximum. I don't want to see a carousel with 15 doggone images. To me, that's a waste of images. For number one, you can use them somewhere else, but I don't want no more than 4. Usage of the following. Man, it's rude. Usage of a left and right collapsible nav bar. Aspect ratio. Image classes rounded, circle, and thumbnail. Aspect ratio correct images. A jumbotron carousel. Buttons. Paginations. List groups. Panel. Drop down menu. Tabs. Modal. media objects, scroll spy, glyphicons, and font awesome, responsive web design, and your pages must be labeled as the follow. And my expectation is to see these on your home page. It must include a jumbotron with four images in the carousel. About page, you can compose it as you deem. Content must be relevant to the page. Portfolio. This page reflects your entire aware projects, completed or not. In other words, we've done four web pages. I expect to see a portfolio of four websites. An image of it, links to it, the whole nine yards. That's what I expect to see. A gallery, your thing, with captions, a minimum of 12 images, use thumbnails and four images across. Huh?
Your cursor's still.
Oh, that's Windows. Your images in your gallery, the destination images should be no smaller. You all right? Huh?
Which
one counted
for four web pages we did?
You want me to count them for you?
Yeah.
Please. You want me to count them for you? The very first page. The very first web page we did, I had you on GitHub, and we created a GitHub web page. And it was just a quick hit GitHub web page.
My basic web page.
My basic web page. That's one. Tim gave you a sheet, and you created a web page. All before me. That's two. So that's two. What web page did we just get finished with?
Cheesecake this week.
But in the Tim web page, did I not give you another web page to do? We amended that web page. Did we not amend that web page? And if I didn't do it, give me what you got. And let me figure out if I did. Because if I go back and count four web pages, I'm sure coming with you tomorrow to the show.
Yeah, lesson two was when we had this
side nav bar. Mm-hmm. Lesson three was the top nav bar. Okay? Yeah. That was going up. Okay?
I had deleted
one. Well, you better find it. Okay. All the images, I don't want to see no little bitty teeny itchy images. I want your destination images, especially when you use that gallery. Your thumbnails can be little, but when we click on it, I won't see no little bitty image in the corner.
And we can make that under any topic?
Any topic you want. You get to choose. I'm just telling you the pages you got to have. Okay? And you got to have a contact page. Okay?
So,
this is our final project. So our last day is what? December 13th. Okay? Questions? Thank you very much. Hope everybody, you can download this sheet or read this sheet on the webpage. And last but not least, just so you know, I gotta put it up there. I didn't have it, but I have it there. I actually have the final page outline for you, how we're going to go about completing this task. So, hope that answers all your questions. That's it for our class today. That's all I have.
That's it, that's all.
Thank y'all, had a ball. Signing off.